Okay, we're going to look today at the fall of Judah, which is really the fall of Jerusalem. And you remember that the United Kingdom divided in 931 BC after Solomon's death. So you had the kingdom, the nation of Israel to the north and Judah to the south. And the northern kingdom of Israel, it continued in existence until it was conquered by the Assyrians. The Assyrians were the dominant power at that time. The northern kingdom continued until it was conquered by the Assyrians. The final blow coming with the fall of Samaria, the capital of Israel, in 722-721 BC. And the guest speaker, Tony Johnson, he mentioned that that last week. What I want to do today is I want to review with you the story of Judah from that point of the fall of the northern kingdom in 722. I want to follow the southern kingdom of Judah from that point down to its fall. It's being conquered by the Babylonians. And the major blow of that, or the final blow there, being the fall of Jerusalem in 587-586. So we're going to go from 722 down to 587-586. But first, I want to back up just a little bit. I want to start, because remember I told you I wanted to run back up and catch some of these kings that we're leaving? I want to start with that. I want to go back to the Uzziah or Azariah. You know, some of these kings have names. People have more than one name, and I know that's confusing, but as I say, that's just how it is. And so Azariah or Uzziah, I want to start with his death in 740 BC. And this was the year that Isaiah had that great vision. Remember the year that King Uzziah died in Isaiah chapter 6, verse 1, where he saw the Lord sitting upon a throne high and lifted up, and the train of his robe filled the temple. And you recall that, or maybe you don't recall, it's been a couple weeks, but Azariah's son, Jotham, he began to reign as a co-regent with Azariah in 750. This is after the Lord struck Azariah with leprosy when he went in and offered the unauthorized incense he's burning, or the sacrifices that he's doing. And when they rebuked him, he got an attitude about it. And so he was struck with leprosy. And in 2 Kings 15, 34 and 35, but Azariah comes in, he's co-regent from 750, and then Azariah dies in 740, and Jotham continues his reign down to 731 B.C. In 2 Kings 15, 34 and 35, it says, and he did what was right, this is Jotham, he did what was right in the eyes of the Lord according to all that his father Uzziah had done. Nevertheless, the high places were not removed. The people still sacrificed and made offerings on the high places. Now, what I want you to see as we go through this, I want you to see, you say, well, why is God destroying Judah? It will be no secret why God destroys Judah. But here you see right here with Jotham, the people are still sacrificing and making offerings on the high places, even though he's relatively good. A good king there. Well, Jotham's followed on the throne by his son Ahaz, who's also called Jehoahaz. That's just how it works. But he's followed on the throne by his son Ahaz. And the chronology of reigns during this particular period is very difficult, and I can't go through. There's a lot of data that must be accounted for. But let me just give you the bottom line from Eugene Merrill, who has spent a lot of time playing with this. And his analysis is accepted by a number of other people. But the bottom line seems to be that Ahaz became a vice regent, kind of a lesser regent of Jotham's in 743, even though Azariah was still alive until 740. But he becomes a vice regent in 743. And then in 735, he becomes a co-equal ruler with his father Jotham, there being no distinction. And then when his father Jotham dies in 731, Ahaz reigns by himself down to 715. That's why I've done it this way. 743, vice regent, 735, co-ruler of equal. And then when he dies, he reigns solo for the next 16 years, 731 to 715. A lot goes into that. Okay? But I think that's right. Somebody say they can't hear? Oh, well, maybe I'm deaf here. All right. I just said I thought we're having problems with the microphone. People tell me we're not, but okay, everybody can hear. Good. All right, so this happened. We go down to 7:15. Now, in 2 Kings 16, okay, this is speaking of Ahaz. 2 Kings 16, it says, he did not do what was right in the eyes of the Lord his God, as his father David had done. But he walked in the way of the kings of Israel. Okay, well, all the kings of Israel are bad, right? So he's walking, this king of Judah is walking in the ways of the kings of Israel. He even burned his son as an offering according to the despicable practices of the nations whom the Lord drove out before the people of Israel. So he has sunk to this, burning his son to these pagan gods. And he sacrificed and made offerings on the high places and on the hills and under every green tree. So he's out just going crazy with idolatry. You can also see this in 2 Chronicles 28, verses 1 to 4. So this is Ahaz. Now Ahaz, he's followed by the very good king Hezekiah. Now Hezekiah served as an assistant to his father from the age of 11, which is in 729 B.C., before he assumes the sole reign upon Ahaz's death in 715. He then reigns alone. After Ahaz dies, he reigns alone from 715 down to 696 B.C., and then the last 10 or 11 years of his reign, he shares as a co-reign with his son Manasseh. Okay, that's reflected here in this chart where you see Manasseh 696, Hezekiah goes down to 686. But that's how that reign works, and it's a sole ruler. Now, I find this interesting. You have here, you have Ahaz, who's terrible, and his son Hezekiah. As soon as Hezekiah becomes the sole ruler, he promptly asserts his loyalty to Yahweh alone. Okay, so this son of this guy who's a pagan worshiper, soon as he becomes the sole ruler, he announces his allegiance to Yahweh alone, and he took steps to restore the worship of Yahweh in Judah. So he's trying to reform things and do things that are right, and he rebelled against the king of Assyria. Now you remember, he comes to the throne as the sole ruler in 715, just 7 years before the Assyrians had finished off his northern neighbor. So they're like a big power, and they're right there. And so he rebels against the king of Assyria. You see that in 2 Kings 18:7. They're the dominant power at that time. Now that rebellion no doubt contributed to Sargon, who's the ruler of Assyria at the time, his military incursion into Judah in 712 B.C. And you see that referred to in Isaiah chapter 20, verse 1. And in fact, Assyrian records, we have a number of Assyrian records, nothing to do with the Bible. Assyrian records refer to Judah at this time as a tribute state. So it seems that Hezekiah was at least temporarily subject to Sargon. So he comes in, he rebels, we have this incursion. Apparently, at least there was some period of time when he's subject to Sargon. But for the remainder of Sargon's reign, Judah was relatively free from Assyrian interference. But that doesn't last long. That doesn't last long. That changes when Sargon, the ruler of Assyria, when he dies and his son Sennacherib comes to the throne in 705 B.C. Okay, the Egyptians, they go and they encourage Hezekiah to rebel against the Assyrians. He had rebelled right when he comes in. We have that incursion in 712. So we know he's prone to that. But with Egyptian encouragement, he rebels against the Assyrians. And you see that in 2 Kings 18, which led to Sennacherib's besieging of the city of Jerusalem in 701 B.C. Now, this is the time where you have this miraculous deliverance by God, where he miraculously spared the city from capture by the Assyrians. You see that in 2 Kings 19, 35 and 37, Isaiah 37, verses 36 to 38. And they report there that an angel destroyed 185,000 Assyrians who were ready to assault the city. So here's the city. Sennacherib's besieging it. And it looks, you know, hopeless. And God, the angel, kills them. Now, it's interesting, too. There is a record where Sennacherib refers, says, I had Hezekiah shut up like a bird in a cage. But he never talks about taking the city. You see, I had him shut up. Just like the text says, I had him. But he doesn't say I conquered the city, which seems to be an interesting omission from these guys who love to boast about their successes. Okay, but that's another archaeological thing that I could show you some stuff on that. But all right, now, ironically, this great deliverance by God, where they're, it looks like, you know, they're doomed, and then they're freed by this angel killing all of these Assyrians, it's turned by Israel into something negative. You see, and what happens is Israel comes to think that God would never allow Jerusalem to be conquered because it was his special dwelling place. Jerusalem is safe. He's never going to allow anything to happen to Jerusalem. In the words of Jeremiah, in Jeremiah chapter 7, verse 11, they came to see the temple as a den of robbers, in the sense of a hideout. That's what he means by den of robbers. You see, they came to see the temple as a den of robbers in the sense of a hideout, a place where the wicked could retreat to safety. You know, this is our place. You know, we do what we want, but we're safe here. God will protect his turf. See, automatically, mechanically, it doesn't matter. It's because this is his spot. He's going to protect it. So we come on in here and we're safe. So you see, this they turn this into something negative by thinking God's protection of Jerusalem has nothing to do with us and our faithfulness and our loyalty. No. God's going to protect his turf, so we're good. He'll never allow this. And they have this idea, and you see later they get rebuked for it. Well, Hezekiah is followed by his son, the wicked king Manasseh. And you just see these changes. It's really interesting to me. Where we'll have a wicked son, a good king, a wicked king. There we have Manasseh who comes to the throne. He reigns in Judah from 696 down to 642 B.C., the first 10 or 11 years of which he's co-regent with Hezekiah. Now, perhaps that co-regency, see, there's a lot of times we don't know what's going on with these co-regencies. Perhaps that co-regency was prompted by Hezekiah's earlier bout with a near-fatal disease, as you see in 2 Kings 20, verse 1, and in 2 Chronicles 32, 24, Isaiah 38, 1. So he had something really serious. So maybe that's what's behind this. But in 2 Kings 21, chapter 2, 2 Kings chapter 21, verse 2 through 9, it says that Manasseh did what was evil in the sight of the Lord according to the despicable practices of the nations whom the Lord drove out before the people of Israel. Why is God destroying Judah? Look at this. They're acting just like the people that he had driven out. He rebuilt the high places that Hezekiah his father had destroyed, and he erected altars for Baal, and he made an Asherah, one of these poles for worshiping a foreign god, as Ahab, king of Israel, had done, and he worshiped all the host of heaven and served them. He built altars to foreign gods in the courts of the Lord's house. Now, you talk about thumbing your nose at God. Listen, you're nothing to me. Yeah, I like this place. Nice digs. It's a good place for me to worship a pagan god. I really like this temple that was built for you. But it's really a good spot. I mean, that's where all the people are. And so this is what they wind up doing. They built the altars to the foreign god. He burned his son as an offering. He used fortune telling and omens, dealt with mediums and with necromancers, those who summon up dead people. He made a carved image of Asherah, set it in the Lord's house. And verse 9 says, Manasseh led the people astray to do more evil than the nations had done whom the Lord destroyed before the people of Israel. So this guy's horrible. Okay, Manasseh is horrible. 2 Kings 21, verse 16, it adds, moreover, Manasseh shed very much innocent blood. So he's not only a rank idolater, he's murdering innocent people. Just killing them. It says, till he had filled Jerusalem from one end of the other, besides the sin that he made Judah to sin, so that they did what was evil in the sight of the Lord. 2 Kings 21, verse 11 and 12, the Lord declared, because Manasseh, king of Judah, has committed these abominations and has done things more evil than all the Amorites did who were before him, and has made Judah to sin with his idols, therefore, thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, behold, I am bringing upon Jerusalem and Judah such disaster that the ears of everyone who hears of it will tingle. There's that line again. The prophets use that line. It's going to be so insane. And when people hear it, they're going to go, oh. You see this image of your ears tingling, because it's just like, oh, man, that bad. And he's telling them that. Well, Manasseh's son, Amon, reigns in Judah for 2 years. He did what was evil, and he walked in the way in which his father walked. And he served the idols that his father served, and he worshipped them. So he's no improvement. Manasseh's horrible. His son walks in his way. And you say, well, why is God going to destroy Judah? That's not the question. The question is, why is he waiting so long to destroy Judah? That's the question. Ammon's son, now here we have Ammon's son, Josiah. He's 8 years old when he begins to reign around 640 B.C. And he reigned 31 years in Jerusalem. He was a good king. So here we have, you have Manasseh, horrible, his son, bad. And yet here's Josiah, who's good. He embarked on a program of very serious religious reform. Josiah, you remember, he's the one where they discover the book of the law. You say, what happened? How could they possibly lose the law? Well, after you had decades of a reign of a guy who's staunchly opposed to the worship of Yahweh, you know how people are. You don't want to put yourselves at odds with the ruling power. So it just got put away. It got lost and forgotten. Who cares? Who's going to be messing with it? Well, the book of the law is found, and Josiah seeks to institute these religious reforms, but it was insufficient to stave off God's judgment. Daniel Block says of Manasseh, Block is an Old Testament scholar, he says, the kingdom of Judah never recovered from the spiritual degradation to which he had brought the nation. After 55 years of court-sponsored paganism, Judean apostasy was so deeply entrenched that the sweeping reforms of the good King Josiah could do no more than scratch the surface, but not for lack of trying. But you see, this paganism had gotten so ingrained and so institutionalized and so stuck into the people after decades and decades. So here comes Josiah, and you see how people, well, I don't know, you know, it was good enough for the old king and all this kind of thing. But Josiah is a good king, and he comes out. Now, Zephaniah, the prophet Zephaniah, he prophesied during Josiah's reign. Okay, Josiah comes to the throne here. He comes to the throne 640. During his reign, Zephaniah prophesies, and Zephaniah says, I will stretch out my hand against Judah and against all the inhabitants of Jerusalem. He's warning the people during the reign of the righteous king Josiah, who's trying to institute reforms. God says through this prophet, I will stretch out my hand against Judah and against all the inhabitants of Jerusalem, and I will cut off from this place the remnant of Baal in the name of the idolatrous priests, along with the priests, those who bow down on the roofs to the host of the heavens, those who bow down and swear to the Lord and yet swear by Milcom, one of these idols. You're going to sit here and add me to a pantheon? Worship them all over the place? Treat me like that? And then he says, Milcom, those who've turned their back from following the Lord, who do not seek the Lord or inquire of them. This is during Josiah's reign that you have this prophet say this. Now, the ancient kingdom of Babylonia. Okay, remember the Assyrians? They're bossing. They're the ones who are in control when they take the northern kingdom of Israel. 722, Samaria goes. They're the dominant power in the ancient Near East. But the ancient kingdom of Babylonia, it began a new rise to prominence. It had been prominent a long time before. But that's why this empire is sometimes called the Neo-Babylonian Empire. Because it began a new rise to prominence with the ascension of Nabopolassar as the Babylonian ruler here in 626. Now, in 612 B.C., the Babylonians in alliance with the Medes, they destroyed the Assyrian capital city of Nineveh as the prophet Nahum had predicted 40 years earlier. So we have the Babylonians in alliance with the Medes. They go in 612 and they destroy the capital of Nineveh, the Assyrian capital. In 610, the Babylonians and their allies take the city of Haran. Now, with that capture, when that city fell, the Assyrian Empire was essentially finished. In 610, it was a fait accompli. The only question was, who's going to control Palestine and Syria? Will it be the Egyptians or will it be the Babylonians? This is my map here. Maybe I ought to turn this way. You see, will it be from the Egyptians down here or the Babylonians from Mesopotamia? Who's going to get that strip of land in the middle? Who's going to control that? Because the Assyrians are now a done deal with the fall of Haran. So this is now in 609, okay, so Haran falls in 610. In 609, this new pharaoh from Egypt, Necho II, he's going up through Palestine because he's going to help the Assyrians try to recover the city of Haran that fell in 610. So this is, you say, why does he want to do that? Well, he fears the Babylonians, apparently. So he's taking his Egyptian army through Palestine in 609. This is when Josiah goes out there. And he's telling him, basically, I got nothing to do with you. I got other business I'm conducting. But they engage, and Josiah is killed in 609 B.C., near Megiddo. Now, after killing Josiah, Pharaoh Necho, he continues northward for this military campaign in northern Syria. So he kills Josiah, he continues on, but the people of Judah, they then make one of Josiah's sons, Shallum, they make him king of Judah. And of course, they give him the throne name Jehoahaz. Okay, so one of Josiah's sons, the people put on the throne after Josiah is killed in that battle. But it says in 2 Kings 23, 31, and 32, he did what was evil in the sight of the Lord, and he reigned only 3 months. He reigns 3 months. What happens? Necho, after he goes up north, does his business up there, he's coming back down. Well, on his return, he deposes that king, Jehoahaz, okay? The son of Josiah that the people had put on the throne. We didn't like that. He comes down. He deposes Jehoahaz. He sends him to Egypt. And he replaces Jehoahaz with another of Josiah's sons, a man named Eliakim. And he renames him Jehoiakim. But that's Necho's guy. Okay, Necho puts Jehoiakim on the throne, and you can see that in 2 Kings 23, 31 to 34, 2 Chronicles 36, 3 and 4, Jeremiah 22, 10 to 12. So this is what happens here. So Jehoiakim, he becomes king in 609, maybe 608. He becomes king at the direction of Necho. Now, we know from Jeremiah chapter 22, Jeremiah chapter 26, 2 Kings 24, that Jehoiakim, this king who'd been put on the throne by Necho, that Jehoiakim, he oppressed the people through forced labor and murder, and he persecuted the prophets who opposed him. Okay, he oppresses the people through forced labor and murder, and he opposes the prophets, or he persecutes the prophets who oppose him. So it's probably, almost certainly, early in Jehoiakim's reign, 608 to 605, right in that window. We know because in 605 you have the Battle of Carchemish, and it becomes clear then who's going to rule Palestine. Okay, the Babylonians have already, they're already there. They've arrived in 605 without question. So it's probably 608 to 605 during this early period in Jehoiakim's reign. It's when the prophet Habakkuk voices this famous complaint to God. This is under Jehoiakim, and he says, how long, Lord, must I call for help, but you do not listen, or cry out to you, violence, but you do not save? Why do you make me look at injustice? Why do you tolerate wrongdoing? destruction and violence are before me. There's strife and conflict abound. Therefore, the law is paralyzed and justice never prevails. The wicked him and the righteous, so that justice is perverted. His question is, how can you turn your back on what's going on in Judah? How can you possibly, being a holy and righteous God, close your eyes to the cesspool that is Judah? Why would God destroy Judah? Listen to the prophet. The prophet's question is, why haven't you destroyed Judah? That's his concern. Why haven't you destroyed Judah? You see, he can't understand. He questions why God hasn't intervened to deal with the evil, the violence, and the injustice that are absolutely rampant in Judah. And God tells him, in essence, I got this. That's what God says to Habakkuk. I got this. I know that you work in a different perspective, a more limited frame. But look, I'm already raising up the Babylonians. They're going to be my instrument of punishing Judah. I'm in the process. I'm taking care of it. Now that raises another question for Habakkuk that I'm not going to pursue. He has an answer for that too, by the way. But he tells him, look, I already have this. I'm raising up the Babylonians. They're going to be my instrument. It only appears, and there's a lesson in this for all of us. You see, it only appears from Habakkuk's limited perspective that God is ignoring Judah's wickedness. He looks around and says, you're not doing anything. I work in my time. You're going to have to trust me with this. You know, I did a great job with the quasars and the sand fleas and everything else. So you just relax. I'm taking care of it. I see it. You see, now, so this is God is not ignoring that. Now, in 605, you see, this is why you think this is the end, where it has to be before that, because in 605, we have this famous battle, the Babylonian Nebuchadnezzar, okay? He's then only the crown prince. He's not been made king. He becomes king later that year. But in 605, he soundly defeats the Egyptians at the Battle of Carchemish, famous battle in history, okay? He defeats the Egyptians at the Battle of Carchemish, so that then establishes, you remember the only question left was after the Assyrians failed, who's going to control Palestine and Syria? Is it going to be the Egyptians or are it going to be the Babylonians? Well, after the Babylonians defeat the Egyptians at Carchemish, that answer's settled. I mean, that question's settled. The answer is the Babylonians are going to rule. They're the ones who are going to be controlling those things. Now, that famous battle, by the way, it's recounted in the Babylonian Chronicle, which archaeologists have recovered, and if we had more time, we'd look at it. Okay, but it's also referred to in Jeremiah chapter 46, verse 2. And Nebuchadnezzar goes on, he becomes king of Babylonia later that year. Now, Daniel chapter 1, verses 1 and 2, it informs us that Nebuchadnezzar, or perhaps subordinates acting under Nebuchadnezzar's orders. But Daniel 1 and 2, we see that Nebuchadnezzar, he came against Jerusalem in 605. So he has this great victory at Carchemish, and either he or some of his subordinates acting under his orders, they come against Jerusalem in 605 under the most likely way of reckoning the reigns of the kings. Now, presumably he does that because Jehoiakim was pro-Egyptian, right? He'd been put on there by Necho. So here he comes, he's now ruling. He comes against Jerusalem, and he took tribute from Jehoiakim in the form of people and various religious articles. That's when Daniel and his compatriots, that's when they're taken into captivity, and Jehoiakim himself was threatened with captivity. You see in 2 Chronicles 36, 5-8. Now, between Josiah's death in 609 and the destruction of Jerusalem by the Babylonians in 587, 586, between those times, we have Zephaniah, who's before that. He's speaking. We have Habakkuk in the window 608 to 605 saying, why aren't you destroying things? But between 609 and 587, 586, the prophet Jeremiah warned the people repeatedly. He's just telling the people repeatedly of the terrible judgment God was going to bring on them, and he suggested that even now there would be hope if they would repent. If they would just turn and seek God, even now there would be hope. But they wouldn't do it. They wouldn't do it. Jehoiakim, he rebelled against Nebuchadnezzar. You see that in 2 Kings 24:1, which led to this massive invasion in 598. This still isn't the destruction of Jerusalem. 605, we get some people carted off, Daniel and his compatriots. 598, 597, we have a rebellion, and this brings a very forceful response from Nebuchadnezzar. And during that time, wouldn't you know it, that Jehoiakim just dies. Okay, well, that's the kind of time you don't like to be second in command. Okay, he dies sometime during that, and he's succeeded by his son, Jehoiakim. Jehoiakim, Jehoiakim. You see, they just have these throne names. So he's succeeded by Jehoiakim, and within a few months of becoming king, Jehoiakim surrenders to the Babylonians without a fight to avoid complete annihilation of the city of Jerusalem. Now the handwriting's on the wall as far as he can see, and he says, okay, here we go. He turns over, he avoids that fight. Well, he, Jehoiakim, the king, he, the royal family, and a large portion of the Judean elite, including the prophet Ezekiel, 597, 598, they're taken into Babylonian captivity. So Daniel 605, here in 598, 597, we have Jehoiakim going into captivity, the royal house, many other people, including Ezekiel, they're carted off into captivity, and they're led into exile, and then more treasures from the temple, more treasures from the royal palace are carried off. Well, Nebuchadnezzar, at that time, he takes their king and takes him into exile. And he appoints Jehoiakim's uncle, Mattaniah, to be the new king of Judah. And he gives him the name Zedekiah. So here's Zedekiah. We have this new king here who's now Nebuchadnezzar's man. Now from captivity, okay, Ezekiel goes into captivity in 598, 597. It's going to be 10 years before Jerusalem is finally destroyed. Ezekiel is in captivity. And from captivity, he repeatedly prophesied of the severe judgment that was about to befall Jerusalem. He's telling the people, you got to stop. Over and over, God's prophet is appealing to the people, telling them the first 24 chapters of Ezekiel are filled with predictions and warnings of the catastrophe that is coming as God's punishment for wickedness. And those chapters include appeals for repentance. In chapter 23, just for example, that's where he tells the story of the two sisters, Ohola and Oholibah. He tells this story of two sisters. And the point of that story, they represent Israel, the one sister, and the other sister represents Judah. And the main point is that despite seeing the punishment that God had brought on Israel, the one sister, Judah continues merrily down the same path. He's saying, you watched what happened to her. And it's like, you got no eyes. And yet you just continue walking down the same path and you think something different is going to happen to you. And this is where I'm telling you that part of what happens is this. They were deceived. They deceived themselves into this lie that God's going to... No, it doesn't matter what we do. He's never going to let anything happen to Jerusalem. Even though he's telling them. What are you, crazy? No, I'm coming. I'm going to do something. You got to stop. You got to stop. You got to repent, repent, repent. You're killing me. Look at what you're doing. He names them. All these things they're doing. You're worse than the people that I drove out. And you think I'm not going to drive you out? But he tells them and tells them. 2 Kings 24:19 says Zedekiah did what was evil in the sight of the Lord according to all that Jehoiakim had done. 2 Chronicles 36:12-16. He did what was evil in the sight of the Lord his God. He did not humble himself before Jeremiah the prophet. I'm not listening to any man. This is a prophet. You're not listening to a man. You're listening to God speaking through a man. And he says, who refused to humble himself before Jeremiah the prophet, who spoke from the mouth of the Lord. See, Jeremiah is still over there. Ezekiel's in captivity. Jeremiah's over there prophesying. Stop, 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 stop. Who are you? I'm not listening to you. Okay, he also rebelled against King Nebuchadnezzar, who had made him swear by God. He stiffened his neck and hardened his heart against turning to the Lord, the God of Israel. All the officers of the priests and the people likewise were exceedingly unfaithful, following all the abominations of the nations. And they polluted the house of the Lord that he'd made holy in Jerusalem. The Lord, the God of their fathers, sent persistently to them by his messengers, because he had compassion on his people and on his dwelling place. But they kept mocking the messengers of God, despising his words and scoffing at his prophets, until the wrath of the Lord rose against his people, until there was no remedy. You see, now this is what happened. You see, when we talk about the Bible, we're talking about the Word of God. This is God speaking to us. And it needs to be heard, submitted to. Why? I don't believe a book. I don't follow a book. I don't follow a book either. I follow the God who wrote the book. Right? This is the way it is with prophets. They scoffed at it. Ah, you know, that's just a thing. You know, who cares? It's God. And so God here was speaking to them. They ignored him. And what wound up happening was is that the rebellion rose till there was no remedy. That was it. It rose till there was no remedy. Now, as a footnote, by the way, it occurs to me in this. Now, you tell me that if Israel or Judah had been a society that bestowed on its people the privilege of having a voice in which person ruled, Josiah, Hezekiah, or Manasseh, do you think God would care how you exercised that choice? Or would it not matter to him? I say to ask the question is to answer it. Okay? Now, that's my footnote for you. Okay, Zedekiah, he eventually rebels against Nebuchadnezzar, as Jehoiakim had done. Now, this is what leads to the destruction of Jerusalem. So we had 605, 598, 597, people carted off, the king carted off, Ezekiel carted off. But we wind up here having Zedekiah, who was Nebuchadnezzar's man on the throne. He's wicked. He rebels against Nebuchadnezzar, which leads to the destruction of Jerusalem, and then to the final exile. The rest of the people, you know, there are some who remain, but they come over, and whoever's left that they think's worth carting off, they're carting off. And that's what they wind up doing. And the fall of Jerusalem, it's reported in 2 Kings chapter 25, verses 1 to 21, 2 Chronicles 36, 17 to 21, Jeremiah 39, 1 to 10, Jeremiah 52, 1 to 30. So you have the account of the fall of Jerusalem in a number of places in Scripture, but the emotional toll of the fall of Jerusalem, that's in Lamentations. You see, and I don't know when it was, not too long ago, in the not too distant past, we studied Lamentations. You see, but you have to understand all of this to understand. What is God doing? Well, what was Habakkuk's point? Habakkuk's point is, why aren't you doing something sooner? We tend to look at it and go, how could a loving God, how could he possibly do what I'm reading in the book of Lamentations? Well, just read some of the background. Read some of the background. God is God. See, God is to be treated with honor and respect. And so when they treated him this way for so long, and he keeps sending people to them, stop, 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 please, 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 drop dead, drop dead, drop dead, drop dead. I don't care, drop dead. All right. Finally rose to the level, it's go time. And that's what happened. So you have to understand that when you read what happened in there, you see the emotional toll in Lamentations. It's just really something. Now, I couldn't resist some archaeological notes. I know the bell will ring soon, but I'm going to give you these just because there's just too much neat stuff here. But we have in Jeremiah 34, verse 7, it refers to Nebuchadnezzar's campaign against Judah. This is when he's coming in 587. This is the final fall. This is the destruction of the city of Jerusalem. He mentions, Jeremiah 34:7, he mentions that Lachish and Azekah These two cities were the only fortified cities in Judea, other than Jerusalem, that were holding out against Nebuchadnezzar's assault. So here we have in Scripture, we have the reference to those two cities as the only fortified cities left other than Jerusalem that are holding out. Now in 1935 and 1938, there's a British excavator named J.L. Starkey. He discovered in the ruins of Lachish, that city, that ancient city, 21 ostraca. Okay, that's just a word for broken pieces of pottery. But he finds 21 ostraca there. And on some of these ostraca, there are messages that had been written during the time of Jeremiah 34, verse 7, when Nebuchadnezzar's army was advancing on Jerusalem. You have the writing on the pot of what's going on here. Most of the letters, they appear to be dispatches from a Jewish subordinate, a man named Hoshea, to his commander Yahush at Lachish. Okay, there's some dispute about his location. Hoshea is apparently stationed at an outpost. And what his job is, he's responsible for looking for the signals from Azekah and Lachish that are coming at that time. So he's watching. He's looking to see what's the state. You know, they didn't have any cell phones or any of that stuff, so they'd have some kind of signal. How are we faring? We're okay. We're still standing. And he's looking in the Lachish Ostrakhan 4. It includes, here you have pictures of two of them. It says, "And let my Lord know that we're watching for the signals of Lachish according to all the indications which my Lord hath given, for we do not see Azekah." You see, so right during this time of advance, right out of the Bible, you have this written here. Now, the Babylonian prism, here's a section of that. 2 Kings 25, Jeremiah 39 to 41, 43 and 52, they mention that this fellow, Nebuzaradan, he's the captain of the Babylonian guard. In Scripture, Nebuzaradan, he's the captain of the Babylonian guard. Well, this prism found in Babylon and published in 1938, it lists, this is a Babylonian document. It lists this guy, Nebuzaradan, as a member of Nebuchadnezzar's court. You see, we say, well, okay, there, all right, but isn't it neat that I have here, I have in the text, people are writing, you say, you know, Nebuzaradan, you say, you know, these guys are just, you know, they made this something centuries later and they're just writing stuff down. I said, well, how is it? Isn't it odd that when we find the Babylonian records, they got the same dude? They got the very same guy in there. It's just really something. Now, Nebo, there's a tablet, Jeremiah 39, verse 3. It's best translated as saying that Nebo Sarsakim, that's how it's translated, English Standard, NIV, TNIV, New English Translation. Best translated as saying that Nebo Sarsakim, a chief officer of Nebuchadnezzar, that he was present at the fall of Jerusalem. Nebo Sarsakim, a chief officer of Nebuchadnezzar, who's present at the fall of Jerusalem. You're going to give me just a second. I know you are. In 2007, a fellow named Michael Jursa, who is an associate professor at the University of Vienna, he's searching the British Museum for Babylonian financial accounts. Quite a job, but that's what he was doing. I mean, you know how these students are, young people looking to publish. he's searching there for these records, and he deciphered a cuneiform inscription on this small tablet you see that had been uncovered in the 1870s and was acquired by the museum in 1920, and it's a receipt dated to the 10th year of Nebuchadnezzar II's reign, which makes it in 595 B.C., and the receipt was for a gift of gold made to a temple in Babylon, which is about a mile from modern Baghdad, a mile north. And the donor identified in that receipt is Nebo Sarsakim, Nebuchadnezzar's chief eunuch. So we got another guy who just turns up in Babylonian records or Assyrian records. And there's a ton of this stuff. But I couldn't go into all of it, and I probably shouldn't have gone into that because I took you over time, but thank you for bearing with me. Bye.